Thanks for coming, Ned.
My pleasure.
So we don't have a lot of time, so we're going to get right into it. First, tell me about an actor who's a friend of yours and a really good actor, really funny actor, been in some Harold Ramis movies, Kurt Fuller.
Oh. Oh, this is brutal. Kurt Fuller, great, great actor. We've acted together several times. I was doing a movie with Kurt. We were playing brothers. And for the only time in my life, the producers, we were out of town, put us in the same bedroom overnight. You know, we're out of town, and so he's in one bed, I'm in the other bed, and I had just had this audition for this movie called Groundhog Day, which was pretty exciting for me, seeing Harold Ramis. And so Kurt says in the night, while we're trying to go to sleep, "So, you doing anything? Anything coming up?" And I knew that actors don't want to hear any other actor say that they have a possibility of a job or anything coming up. So I said, no, Kurt, you know, just knocking on doors, the same old, same old. And I said, "You got anything coming?" He goes, "Oh yeah, actually I do. I'm going to be in this movie called Groundhog Day. I'm playing this great character, Ned Ryerson. Harold Ramis is a friend of mine, and we've been rehearsing, and I'm in bed, like, looking at the roof, going like, oh my God, this is going to be a terrible, terrible story for one of us or both of us." So the next day, I had a call back, and so after we shot our scenes in Paris, California, I drove the 2 hours and 40 minutes to audition again for Harold Ramis, and on the way back, I found out that I got the part of Ned. And Kurt found out, too. And it was brutal. And the only thing I could say about this was, Kurt was so angry and so hurt, as he should have been.
Because he thought he had it at this
point. He had. Well, they had been rehearsing. Yeah, he had it. Opening night, when we opened Groundhog Day, in front of the theater was Kurt Fuller. And he said, "I'm going to watch this movie with you." So we sat there and watched Groundhog Day together. First time I had seen it, and it was so good. And then we stood up and he said, "Well, you got my part, but at least you did a good job with it. Congratulations." He shook my hand and hugged me. And I thought, if ever I could have that kind of class to do that. And fortunately, Kurt and I have worked together since
then. He's had a terrific career, and he's a really good actor. So it's rare, because you guys never tell the story of whose part you beat out. But in this case, Kurt knows it, and it was such a strange circumstance. You're in a hotel room together. It
terrible.
Never happens like that. Yeah.
Terrible. It's a horrible business if anyone wants to be an actor. Just...
What, we were just talking backstage, that first time you saw it, you know, a very typical question to ask is, you know, did you know that you were making this masterpiece at the time? And that's almost always no, but when you saw it that first time, you had an idea.
My first thought, just as someone who loves film, I went like, well, this is a perfect movie. Not only was it a perfect comedy, but if you recall, comedies at that time always used to ruin themselves by having the credits at the end being outtakes of the actors, like, forgetting their lines. It was a big deal at the time. But Groundhog Day was beautiful and perfect from beginning to end. And I was mightily impressed.
Especially in a comedy like this, especially with a comedy with a famously gifted improv performer like Bill Murray working for Harold Ramis. This was their sixth movie together. You would expect that there would be a lot of improvised scenes. But the day repeats itself, so the scenes, as you do them, and you have to do them again and again, have to be identical.
Now, don't you tell me you don't remember me, because I sure as heck fire remember you.
Not a chance.
There's no improvisation. In fact, the first scene, can I stand up? Is that possible?
No, Stephen. Of course you can stand up.
The first scene where I'm walking across the street and I see him, it was, "Oh, Bill Con-," and I had to step on the exact same brick in the street. And there was a man It was his first job. This is where you begin in film. His first job was there on the ground, and it was to that's where you stepped on the brick. So as an actor, you know, okay, I have to land on this face. So you go, one, two, three. Now I'm off camera. Action. Bum, bum, bum. Oh, Phil, you know? And he's there doing this. That guy, Jim Kesselweis, ended up being my producer on Silicon Valley. So you have to be very nice to the guys who do this, because it could come back and haunt you. But we had no improvisation. Everything had to be the same except, yes.
And so this is different days. So first of all, I think you guys shot about 9 scenes together, and then Harold Ramis used 4 or 5 of them, something like that.
Yeah.
But you actually shot many more than 9 because you had to shoot each of them in different types of weather.
Harold Ramis had not decided what the weather of the day that's repeated would be. Because
you shot this starting in March in Chicago, so some days are 58 degrees and sunny, and other days it snows 8 inches.
It's freezing,
yeah.
And so meteorologically it had to be the same day. So Bill and I shot these 9 scenes in sun, in rain, in snow, in sleet, and in gloom. And I think in the end, Harold Ramis picked the gloom to be the day that is repeated. And when snow falls at the end is when time starts again.
Yeah. And there's one improvised scene. And I think we can just do that. The moment when you're hugged.
The one improv scene?
Yeah, where Bill hugs you.
Yes, yes, yes. There's one scene that was improvised. And I think there were dirty tricks involved. It's the scene where Bill hugs me on the street.
I have missed you so much.
That was not in the script. Where, Ned, are you busy later? That was all made up, and Harold Ramis had cameras. Maybe Harold knew about it, but I had no idea. And so we had the camera set up, and we did it in one take. Harold Ramis says, I think we have that.
It says something about your ability to respond to a moment as an actor that you didn't expect to happen, that you have a very particular reaction that is the button on the scene, and it's why you didn't have to shoot another one, I think, because it's so perfect.
It's good to see you, Phil.
Then the movie's done, you finish shooting it, and then you were called back. And by the way, Stephen has written 3 books, so you are a writer. And you end up writing this other scene.
I had finished all my Ned stuff. I went home to Annie and our little boy, Robert, and I get a call from Trevor Albert, our executive producer, and saying, we want some more Ned in the movie. And, okay, but there was no more Ned in the script. So I flew back. And we had the Veterans of Foreign Wars Hall for like a week. And Harold Ramis says, don't worry, we'll figure out something to shoot. We'll come up with some pages or something. We'll get. And Bill Murray said to me, he says, as far as I'm concerned, you're only here to eat craft services. So I went back to the trailer. The days went by. There was no script. There was no nothing. And so I wrote a scene. And we ended up having like 2 hours left of the set before we lost it. They finally called Bill and I in to shoot the scene. And Harold Ramis says, well, we don't have anything. Do you want to make something up? I said, well, I wrote a scene. And Harold Ramis said, well, let me see.
Was it like on a legal pad?
On legal pad. I just wrote a scene kind of that would fit into the movie. And Harold Ramis read it and said, like, oh, yeah, we could shoot this. Bill, it was a scene where I had most of the lines because I wrote it and I would remember it. But Bill had the joke. See, Bill had the joke. And that's the important thing. I have the setup, but he had the joke. And then Bill looked at it and said, like, okay, we could shoot this, but we'll only do one take. We'll only do one take of it. So it was at the slave auction. And it's where I come in and tell Andy about all the kinds of insurance Bill bought from me and how it was the greatest day of my life. And I got no writing credit for that. I've got no checks from the Writers Guild. Thank you, Danny Rubin.
There's also, first of all, real quick, so it's your experience, you know, this famously is the movie that broke up the wonderful friendship between Bill and Harold Ramis, the sixth and final movie together. But your experience with Bill, all your scenes are with Bill, was terrific, yeah?
It was terrific. He was one of the best actors in my life I've ever worked with because he was always in the moment, all the time, for every take we'd, and like you were saying, Ben, you know, we had to do so many takes over and over and over again, the same thing over, but Bill is always in it, never phoned it in, always was real, always looking in your eye and telling the truth. So I had a fantastic experience with him. You know, she's just a terrific actor.
And finally, I want to say Harold Ramis' strength as a director, and he's a wonderful writer and a wonderful actor. He always wanted to be like, he wanted to be known like a director who also writes. Like, he was a filmmaker, and he wanted to be taken seriously as one, and he earned that. So you guys spent days and hundreds of thousands at a bare minimum, maybe $1 million, on one scene, right? One big scene that Harold Ramis had the courage to just...
Yeah, it probably is what made the movie what it is. At the beginning of the first week was a lot of Bill and I shooting the street scene over and over again. But then there was this big set piece where Bill realizes he has no consequences. And he goes, it's the typical Bill Murray going nuts scene, where he's like spray painting the inside of the inn and chainsawing the furniture in two and cutting his hair into a mohawk, this whole long scene. And if you know anything about filmmaking, you know anything you paint, you have to unpaint for the second take. Anything you cut in half, you have to have other pieces to replace them. Bill's mohawk wig cost something like $10,000. It was tons. And something Alan Parker told me is all the footage you do the first week is the most important footage for a director in a movie, because that's what the money men, that the studio was looking at, to saying, how is our money being spent? And they shot that scene, it was like 2.5 days, and Harold Ramis looked at the footage and threw it away. And he said to us and to Danny Rubin, the writer, he said, we have to really decide what story we're telling here. Is it a movie that's going to be about Bill with no consequences, which was a very popular film at the time? You know, Bill Murray without consequences is a winner. It's very funny.
That's right.
But he said the film is about more than that. And I learned later from Harold, after the movie was done, when I asked him, how many days is Bill trapped in town? And he said, well, I'm a practicing Buddhist. Who knew? And Buddhists believe it takes 10,000 years to perfect the human soul. And the story of Groundhog Day is about the perfection of the human soul. And I think that's why I thought it was a perfect movie when I first saw it.
Yeah, and a movie that is about the perfection of the human soul, no matter how funny that is, does not include a guy cutting his hotel room in half and shaving his head into a mohawk, right?
Right.
That's a different movie.
Right.
That is a different movie. Steven, I could talk to you about Groundhog Day, about your career forever, but we got to show the movie. You guys are very fortunate here in this wonderful theater to see really one of the great comedies, not merely of its time, but of all time. Steven Tobolowsky as Ned Ryerson, a huge, huge part of that success. Steven, thank you for being here.
Thank you.